me out of darkness. Know that we are that. And now, The Telltale Heart, a classic of Gothic fiction by Edgar Allan Poe.
First published in James Russell Lowell's The Pioneer in January 1843.
True. Very, very nervous I had been and am. But why would you say that I am mad? The disease has sharpened my senses, not dulled them. Above all, a sense of hearing was acute. He heard all things in the heaven and in the earth.
He heard many things in hell.
How then am I mad?
Hearken,
observe how healthily, how calmly we can tell you the whole story. It is impossible to say when first the idea entered my brain, but once conceived, it haunted me day and night.
Object there was none.
Passion there was none. He loved the old man who had never wronged him. He had never given an insult. For his gold, he had no desire.
I think it was his eye.
Yes, it was this.
One of his eyes resembled that of a vulture, a pale blue eye with a film over it. Whenever it fell upon him, his blood ran cold. And so, by degrees, very gradually, he made up his mind to take the life of the old man and thus rid himself of the eye.
Now this is the point. You fancy me mad, but you should have seen me. You should have seen how wisely I proceeded. With what caution, with what foresight, with what dissimulation. He went to work and was never kinder to the old man than during that whole week before he killed him.
Every night, I turned the latch of his door and opened it. Oh, so gently. And when the opening was sufficient for my head, I put in a dark lantern all closed.
Closed so that no light shone out.
And then I thrust in my head.
He moved it slowly, very slowly, so that he might not disturb the old man's sleep.
It took him an hour to get his whole head within the opening, so far that he could see as he lay upon his bed.
Ah, what a madman, even as wise as
his head. When his head was well in the room, he undid the lantern cautiously.
Oh, so cautiously.
For the hinges creaked.
He undid it just so much that a single thin ray fell upon the vulture eye.
And this I did for 7 long nights, and never was the vulture eye opened. So it was impossible to do my work.
For it was not the old man who vexed him, but his evil eye.
Upon the 8th night, he was more than usually cautious in opening the door. A watch's knitted hand moves more quickly than it is
never before. And I felt the full extent of my powers.
To think that there he was, opening the door little by little, and the old man not even to dream of his secret deeds or thoughts. He fairly chuckled at the idea, and perhaps the old man heard him, for he moved on the bed suddenly as if startled.
You may think that I drew back, but no!
The room was black as pitch with the thick darkness. He kept on it, pushing on. His head was in. He was about to open the lantern when my thumb caught the latch and the old man sprang up in bed, crying out, "Who's there?"
He kept quite still and said nothing.
Presently, he heard a low groan. Oh, I knew it was the groan of mortal terror.
It was not a groan of pain or of grief or horror.
It was the low, stifled sound that rises from beneath the soul when overcharged with awe.
He knew that the old man had been lying awake and that his fears had been ever since growing upon him.
He had been trying to fancy them causeless, but he could not. He kept saying to himself, "It is nothing but the wind in the chimney. It is only a mouse crossing the floor.
It is merely a cricket which has made a single chirp."
Yes, he was trying to comfort himself with these suppositions, but he found all in vain.
All in vain. Because death, in approaching him, had stalked with his black shadow before him and enveloped the victim.
When I had waited a long time, then, patiently, I resolved to open up a crevice, very, very small crevice in the lantern. A small ray of light shot out, like the thread of a spider web, across the room, and fed upon the vulture eye. It
was open! Wide, wide open, and he grew furious as he gazed upon it.
He saw it with perfect distinction. A pale blue, with a thin veil covering it, that chilled the very marrow in his bones.
But he could see nothing else of the old man's face or his person, for he had directed the ray as if by instinct precisely upon the damned spot.
Now, if you remember, I told you that what you mistake for madness is merely an over-acuteness of the senses. It's my ears, a low, dull, thudding sound, like a sound of a watch mixed with a drum and cotton. It was the beating of the old man's heart. It drove me into a fury, the way a drum beat stimulates a soldier into courage.
And yet he refrained and kept still.
He scarcely breathed. He held the lantern motionless.
From the heavy statue of the heart continued, louder and louder and quicker and quicker every moment.
The old man's terror must have been extreme.
Louder and louder, I say.
Louder, louder, and let the general smile upon storytellers tonight are members of the troupe called Phantasmagoria under the direction of John Dodonna. They did a fabulous job. You should check them out. Phantasmagoria.com. I think. If you're not sure how to spell that, neither am I. It's listed in your program, so be sure to check them out when you can all around town, especially this time of year. As I said, we're going to give you sort of the classic, iconic Halloween soundtrack. That moves. That's awesome. It's going to come in really handy later. We'll see. Anyway, you can't play iconic, spooky, fun, familiar music without including this next piece. Again, it plays really well in this town because of its connection, again, to Fantasia, or making spell our magic is a good one. You'll hear that door. But really, Public House is about iconic, famous, familiar piece of storytelling through music called The Sorcerer's Apprentice. It might be just the most iconic song for this time of year ever. It's an incredibly challenging piece of music that features the whole breadth of this orchestra. And it's an incredible, incredible, powerful accomplishment to put something like this together for you tonight. So, without further ado, I'll give you The Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Thank you.
audience, thank you so much. Believe it or not, we have reached it. Just about the end of our evening. We have one final piece here tonight, and we're hoping that you are ready to have a really good time. But before we wrap up for this evening, concerts like this do not come together all on their own. So please, we are so fortunate to have a beautiful, gracious welcoming home here at Calgary. The stage is stunning. For an orchestra our size, there are not a lot of places in town that we fit. So the fact that we have this much space is incredible. The crew here at Calgary has been wonderful. The entire facility has been available to us this week as we've put this together. So please give a really warm, warm round of applause for our first team. If Joshua were up here, and those of you who know Joshua, he would love to be up here. If you were up here tonight, he would want you to know about all of the other incredible things that are going on in this organization. We are just one part of a larger organization called Central Florida Community Arts, cfcarts.com. Check it out, check us out, find a place to get involved. We have a huge community choir, 300 voices that we're putting on an incredible concert. Many of you here tonight. This December for Christmas in Toyland, which will be up at the Northland Church in Longwood. You definitely want to check that out. We now have a young artist orchestra, high school, middle school, and elementary school students learning to play music like this. We have a chill out youth arts program as well. You're putting on a great performance in November right here. You need to check out everything that's going on in our community, cfcarts.com. Please check it out. And if you are interested in getting involved, if you play an instrument, if you sing, if you just like to be around people who are having a really good time, we have a place for you, so please jump in and figure that out. I promised you earlier this evening that we would hear a little bit more of Julian Bond's work before we leave town. So our final piece for tonight, again, is another custom arrangement specifically for us. If there is one piece of music more iconically Halloween than The Sorcerer's Apprentice, it would probably be Michael Jackson's Thriller. But because we can't make it just once, we took a look at all of Michael Jackson's great work, much of which comes from the Thriller album, and we decided to give you an entire collection, sort of a retrospective, a classical orchestral take on some of the great hits of Michael Jackson. So if you know it, sing along, if you feel it moving, if you got something you really got, I totally don't do what I did, that looks silly. Please, thank you for laughing at me, I appreciate it. It's good. Hopefully no lights, you can't see that I'm blushing. So please enjoy yourself. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. Thank you for being a part of this journey that we are on. We will do this same concert again tomorrow night. So tell your friends, help us get some more people here tomorrow night, or come back and see me again just because you're having that good of a time. But we leave you tonight with a little Michael Jackson collection, Thriller.